alert1 is the typical JavaScript payload to prove that you found a cross-site scripting security vulnerability. And in this video, I want to explain why we use alert in the first place, but also why you should not use alert1 and instead use alert document.domain, alert window origin, or maybe even console.log. This is very important to understand when you are hunting for XSS issues, especially on very modern web applications. It allows you to assess the impact that your XSS has, and so it's crucial to determine if you actually found a critical vulnerability or maybe an invalid issue. So first of all, why do we use alert? Actually, I don't know historically why, but it has two huge advantages. First of all, the obvious, it's very visual. If you randomly try to put XSS payloads in various input fields and then continue to browse a website, you might just see an alert pop up, which means you don't need to carefully investigate each input. This is why XSS can be very simple to hunt for, at least the basic XSS cases. It's as simple as spray the input around and pray that an alert pops up. But there is another advantage to alert. There are some browser client-side JavaScript frameworks with templating features allowing some limited form of JavaScript. And you can imagine that if you have input where you allow some restricted version of JavaScript, for example, printing some scope variables or doing basic math, then if you can inject this, it doesn't matter for security. You can't do anything evil with that. However, alert is a function that is part of the window object. And the window object holds the most critical data an attacker might be interested in. For example, the local storage, which might contain session tokens, or the famous window document cookies. This means executing alert can be an indication that your XSS finding has a high severity. But as a small side note, nowadays we mostly have given up on these restricted JavaScript templates, as it was a cat and mouse game with fixes and bypasses, and we learned it's too hard. Check out the history on AngularJS sandboxing attempts if you are interested in that. I also have a small playlist about this. Anyway, even though it seems that alert1 is a great indication for XSS injection actually being critically exploitable, it's not a good metric anymore. Even if you see an alert pop up, it might not be a security issue. This might be a bit surprising to you. Why would an alert pop up not be a security issue? I hope I can explain that to you. And this is where alert document.domain or alert window.origin come into play. With those, it's much clearer for you to understand if you found a critical XSS vulnerability. And so if you use that in a bug bounty report, then it's also easier for Google to review your finding as well. So let's investigate why this is the case. I'm using Google's blogger service as an example. Keep in mind the date of this video, bug bounty scope information might change over time, but right now all subdomains of blogger are in scope. And when you explore the features of blogger, you might come across a feature that allows you to put arbitrary HTML into your own blog, which means you can inject a script tag with an alert1. You don't know yet where or if it executes, so you continue to use the page. Maybe you write the blog post and then you hit the preview button, and suddenly you see the famous XSS payload trigger. Look, the domain is blogger.com and that site is in scope, right? Give me bounty, please. Did we really just find an easy critical XSS bug on Google's service? Well, actually, we did not. To explain why, let's modify the alert1 to the preferred alert document.domain and try it again. We save the new payload and preview the blog post again, the XSS triggers, but it shows the domain usersubdomain.blogspot.com. So why does this XSS trigger on this blogspot.com and not blogger.com? The reason is simple. Look into the Chrome Developer Tools. This website, blogger.com, actually has an iframe where it embeds the usersubdomain.blogspot.com site, and the XSS is located on this domain, not on blogger.com. So no, we did not find a real XSS on the in-scope URL blogger.com. But hopefully you ask yourself now, why does Google use two different domains to implement the blogger service? Well, XSS is a reason. Google uses a range of sandbox domains to safely host user-generated content. Many of these sandboxes are specifically meant to isolate user-uploaded HTML and JavaScript and make sure that they can't access any user data. So what exactly does that mean? The goal of an XSS attack, like with any hacking attack, is to access stuff you shouldn't have access to. For example, the cookies of another user. But the cookies are on the blogger.com domain, so XSS on user-subdomain.blogspot.com cannot read those cookies. It's simply not possible, thanks to the same origin policy. These are considered two different websites. And that's why we want to look at the document.domain or window.origin in the alert, because it tells us on which domain this XSS is actually executed. It tells you what data can this XSS access. And it can only access stuff on user-subdomain.blogspot.com. Google wanted to allow users to customize their own blogs and allow them to include arbitrary HTML and thus JavaScript. But they also want to make sure that this cannot be used to attack other blogger users via an XSS. Thus, they put the user data on this other domain and embed it via an iframe. So, when you see an alert pop up, make sure to do it with document.domain or window.origin, so you can check if your XSS triggers on a critical domain or on an unimportant sandbox domain. This decides if you found an actual security issue or not. Now, besides sandboxing via actually different subdomains or origins, there exists also the concept of sandboxed iframes. I have introduced this before in a video I made, Google Script Gadgets, Google Docs, XSS Vulnerability Walkthrough. Here, Google implemented a so-called JSONP sandbox. They basically injected an iframe with a user-controlled XSS payload, but also set the sandbox attribute on the iframe. To better understand this, let's do some experiment with iframe sandboxes. I've implemented here a very simple tool that allows users to execute JavaScript expressions via eval. You can write 1 + 2 and it prints the result 3. You can also see here a secret session token, and of course it's no problem to execute alert document.session to prove that you can steal the secret session token. But look at the second example. It has essentially the same features, but this time the script being executed is inside of this iframe, which also has a sandbox attribute. But ignore the implementation details, try to execute alert again. And you see it works. So is this equally vulnerable as the previous example? No. Try to alert the secret session token. It won't work. And to see why, simply use the preferred alert document.domain or alert window.origin. And you will see that it's empty. This is a bit different from the sandbox subdomain blogger uses, but you can see that this sandboxed iframe also has a different origin, albeit a weird origin. It is isolated from the website it is embedded into. You cannot steal the secret session. So this achieves the same isolation as the blogspot subdomain did. This alert would not be a valid security issue. That's why you always want to alert the document.domain or window.origin. But before we end this video, I want to give you another tip when hunting for XSS issues. First of all, if you find an injection into a sandboxed iframe, it's uncommon that allow modals option is enabled. For example, here on sites.google.com, you can also create your own website and embed a raw HTML code, similar feature like on Blogger. Thus, you can also embed a XSS payload. But when you try it, nothing would happen. However, if you are an experienced bug hunter, you might always have a look at the DevTools, and then you might notice that alert is blocked due to a sandboxed iframe. So in this case, it would be better to use console.log to actually see where or if it is executing your XSS payload. But this means you need to pay very close attention to the console output of the DevTools, maybe use filters to quickly identify them. As you can see, hunting for XSS can be a bit more cumbersome. Anyway, we did execute JavaScript and confirmed that by executing console.log. So did we find an actual XSS on sites.google.com? That would be in scope, right? Do I get a bounty now? Well, again, we want to look at the actual execution context by looking at the document.domain output. And when we change our payload to that and look at the page executing this payload again, you see that we are on another sandbox domain, this time googleusercontent.com. So no, this apparent XSS is not really a vulnerability. It's by design put on another domain to make it harmless. So now that you know how to identify when a XSS is invalid, you might ask yourself, Why should I even be interested in further investigating an XSS in a sandboxed iframe or on a sandboxed domain? Because it doesn't qualify for a bounty, right? When you have, for example, an injection into a JSONP sandboxed iframe, the actual site usually communicates with the iframe via post messages. And so there could be a way to exploit a message to get XSS on the actual site, basically doing a sandbox escape. But in this case, the vulnerability is not this first XSS. The vulnerability is the escape out of it. So reporting the sandbox XSS itself does not qualify for a bounty, but it means if you can somehow chain other bugs escalating it and execute JavaScript on the actual in-scope domain, then it would be a valid issue you can report. But you see, those are really advanced XSS issues, so make sure you really understood it and don't just report invalid XSS findings. So to summarize, most important for you to remember is that Google intentionally allows XSS by design on sandbox subdomains or sandboxed iframes, and a simple alert is not proof enough that you actually found a serious XSS issue. You should always look at the actual domain the XSS is executed on by using a payload like alert document.domain or alert window.origin. Hopefully now you understand why sandbox subdomains and sandbox iframes are cool, at least for defense, but unfortunately that also means an XSS on there is not actually a security vulnerability that a bug bounty program would pay for. I know it kind of sucks when you see an alert trigger, but it turns out to be on a sandbox domain, but if you find such an invalid XSS, be happy anyway. It could be useful for a longer chain, so take notes and remember where you found it, but also understand that by itself, it's not a valid issue. And now, good luck hunting.